Greetings all, Ferrari Mount 601 here. Welcome back to another 1/18th scale model car review of this, the 2019 Alfa Romeo C38, rendered in 1/18th scale for us by Mini Champs. 2019, it was a very pivotal year for Alfa Romeo in Formula One, as it represented the first time since 1985 that a car branded outright as an Alfa Romeo took part in the Formula One World Championship. The car's immediate predecessor and its obvious design inspiration, the Sauber C37, it marked the end of an era. Sauber finally leaving Formula One, as in the Sauber name no longer would be on the grid. For the first time since 1993, Alfa Romeo having taken a controlling stake of that team at the end of 2017. They retained the Sauber name for 18, but for 19, Sauber well and truly was off the grid, and a new era for the team from Switzerland began. The team retained Kimi Raikkonen and Antonio Giovinazzi, Raikkonen coming over from Ferrari in 2018, where he took his last Grand Prix victory at the 2018 United States Grand Prix, and recently, as an aside, Raikkonen received the car with which he won the United States Grand Prix for Ferrari, so interesting story there. But Raikkonen, a new arrival in 2019 for Alfa Romeo, obviously being a sister company of Ferrari. Antonio Giovinazzi came in from the reserve duties there for Sauber to the second race seat at Alfa Romeo. The car's design, it is an evolution of the Sauber C37, as we already stated. The chief designer and technical director of the team was Simone Resta, and he was delegating responsibilities to chief designer Luca Furbato and Jean Monchot, the head of aerodynamics. Technical specifications on the car are par for the course, as you would expect from a Formula One car of late 2010s vintage, and we will go into the specifics on those to come. Unfortunately, this particular Alfa Romeo, not as prestigious as some of its predecessors, both in racing as well as for road use. Out of 21 races entered, the car managed to score 0 wins, 0 podium finishes, 0 pole positions, and 0 fastest laps. In total, it scored 57 points in the Constructors' Championship, good for 8th place. However, the car did manage to finish 4th and 5th at the Brazilian Grand Prix in the hands of Raikkonen and Giovinazzi, respectively, for their best result of the season. This Mini Champs model, though, it's a little bit of a departure from what we generally see from Mini Champs, and we'll go into the specifics on that for this model's sake of being a model in its own right later on. But sit back, relax, and join me for this look at the 2019 Alfa Romeo C38 in 1/18th scale. The Alfa Romeo C38, well, certainly not one of the more illustrious cars ever produced by the storied Italian mark. However, it is the Formula One car with which Alfa Romeo competed in the 2019 World Championship. Much like its predecessor, the C37, which was officially called the Sauber C37, it is an evolutionary design of the car that they fielded the year before. This car, though, being the first officially to be branded as an Alfa Romeo through and through, Sauber still technically being the team entrant name for the 2018 championship. Even though Alfa Romeo by that point had purchased a controlling stake in the team, they still kept the Sauber name for one more year. But for 2019, the team and the car both were branded outright as Alfa Romeos. In keeping with the traditional evolution of Formula One design, we have several people involved in the initial design and manufacture and implementation of all of the components that were brought on for the 2019 championship for Alfa Romeo. Lead designer and technical director of the Alfa Romeo team, Simone Resta, and he is supervising Luca Furbato and Jean Monchot, who was the chief aerodynamicist. Luca Furbato, of course, was the chief designer as well. He was under the technical director, Simone Resta. The car's immediate predecessor, the Sauber C37, as we mentioned before, in terms of the last car competing in the prior season. However, the last Alfa Romeo branded Formula One car outright was actually the Alfa Romeo 185T that competed for the team in Benetton colors, believe it or not, all the way back in 1985. So the first Alfa Romeo branded Formula One car since 1985. So this car had some pretty high expectations to fill. Unfortunately, it didn't quite meet all of them. technical specifications on the C38, first of all. As we've been seeing on Formula One cars for basically the last 20 years now, front suspension, as you see it passing by there, that is a double wishbone pushrod arrangement. The pushrods there actuating inboard mounted springs and dampers, and of course, those pushrods going up at a roughly acute angle going up into the monocoque there from the wheel hubs. The rear suspension is a multi-link arrangement actuated by pushrods actuating dampers there on the sides of the gearbox casing. So, double wishbone pushrod suspension and double wishbone pull rod suspension, front and rear respectively. This is par for the course in modern day Formula One design. I cannot recall the last time definitively that we saw a pushrod rear suspension on a Formula One car. I'd like to say it was sometime around 2013 though. I know that Red Bull have been using that arrangement since 2009, I want to say it was, but now everybody is using that in the 2019 season and the 2020 cars to the extent that we have seen them also making great use of pushrod rear ends. Overall length on the C38, 5,500 millimeters exactly, or 216 and a half inches. Width is 2,000 millimeters exactly, or 78.7 inches. Height is 950 millimeters, or 37.4 inches. So basically, those are the homologated dimensions that a Formula One car must have. Of course, things like wheelbase and height are technically variable. However, we have got ourselves that homologated track of 2,000 millimeters exactly, and that is what the regulations absolutely stipulate. The engine in the back of the C38 was the Ferrari Type 064. It is a 1.6-liter direct-injected turbocharged V6 at a 90-degree bank angle. Of course, all of that is also homologated in the technical regulations. Rev limit on that V6 engine, 15,000 RPM. However, in practice, we very rarely, if ever, see the engines revving that high due to the fuel flow limits that start to come into force at around 10,500 RPM. Most of the time, you'll see these guys upshifting at about 11,500 to 12,100 RPM. I don't think I've ever seen 15,000 RPM at full throttle accelerating. Supplementing the V6 engine, though, we do have the turbocharger, as we mentioned before, but we also have a hybrid powertrain component in a Formula One car that is designed and manufactured by Ferrari, used in the Ferrari Formula One car, as well as here in the Alfa Romeo. That is a kinetic energy recovery system that runs off of the rear axle, which deploys energy into the rear axle, as well as harvests energy from the rear axle. As the car is decelerating, some of that momentum is captured via electrical energy and put into a battery pack underneath the car's fuel tank. We also have a secondary hybrid system on this car that is run off of the turbocharger. Much like the system that's run off of the rear axle, the turbocharger also has rotational momentum because it has to spool up and down to compress the air going into the inlet charge on the engine. As the turbocharger is spinning, it's actually connected to a little shaft, which is connected to an electric motor, and when an electric motor is turned without any current going into it, it's actually an electrical generator, meaning the turbocharger drives a generator, which then puts electrical energy into that same battery pack that's also charged off of the rear axle. When the car is accelerating, though, some of the energy in that battery pack can be sent back into that electric motor generator unit and spool up the turbocharger. Thus, we can eliminate turbo lag, effectively, on these modern Formula One engines. The turbochargers are not exclusively driven by exhaust pressure. They are also electrically driven. Therefore, turbo lag is a thing of the past. The transmission in this car, it is a Ferrari-designed and manufactured 8-speed, sequential gearbox, paddle-actuated, of course, 6-speed, I've been talking about IndyCar for a little bit too long lately, but no, it is an 8-speed semi-automatic paddle shift unit. Carbon components in the gearbox, including the gearbox casing, exclusively carbon, so we have extremely light weights and we have extremely compact packaging on these units, but 8 forward ratios in there, plus, of course, reverse. That gearbox is driven through a carbon composite clutch, a multi-plate clutch arrangement, very small and lightweight clutches on a Formula One drivetrain as well, but they are immensely strong and immensely resilient because they do have to deal with a lot of torque and, of course, a lot of temperature. Overall weight of the car, 740 kilograms per the regulations. That's 1,631.4 pounds in old money. Car is fueled by Shell, as you can see there on the sponsorship on the monocoque on the forward section there. Brakes, 6-piston Brembo calipers and discs. Those are carbon-carbon discs, and they're carbon ceramic pads, of course, that are running through the calipers and actually clamping onto the discs there. These cars can stop like nothing else you've ever seen. Tires, homologated, Pirelli P0 for dry weather and Pirelli Cinturato for the dry, for the wet conditions, rather. There are two compounds there of the wet weather tire. There's an intermediate compound as well as a full wet compound with a full tread block on it, looking very much like a road tire, but a lot more expensive than one. Competition history on the C38. Well, this is where things get a little bit less rosy. We mentioned that this car had a lot of history behind it in terms of the legacy of Alfa Romeo in Formula One, as well as all of the modern investment now that Alfa Romeo and the Fiat Group have made in this team, purchasing the Sauber team outright, putting their name on it. Well, out of 21 races that this car entered, the first of which being the 2019 Australian Grand Prix and the last being the 2019 Abu Dhabi Grand Prix, drivers Kimi Raikkonen and Antonio Giovinazzi, well, what did they achieve? Out of 21 starts, 0 wins, 0 podium finishes, 0 pole positions, and 0 fastest laps. Not so rosy. The car's best result happened at the Brazilian Grand Prix, where Kimi Raikkonen managed to finish 4th and Antonio Giovinazzi managed to finish 5th. So, double points finish, very high up into the points finishers as well for Formula One standards. Remember, only the top 10 finishers in Formula One actually score points. So, 4th and 5th, that actually netted Alfa Romeo the majority of the season's points haul. They finished the Constructors' Championship with 57 points on the board, which was good enough for 8th in the World Championship. So, certainly not something to write home about, but 8th in the World Championship out of 10 teams, there are two guys behind you, so job done, especially for Alfa Romeo's first full season back as a fully-fledged constructor in their own right, competing for the Formula One World Championship. And of course, when you've got a driver like Kimi Raikkonen driving for you, Kimi Raikkonen, of course, the 2007 Formula One World Champion, he won that for Ferrari, you've got some high expectations, and despite the car being somewhat the limiting factor there, I think Raikkonen in particular got the most out of this car that it possibly could have had to give, so there it is. However, we do very much need to take a look at this wonderful model brought to us in 1/18th scale by Minichamps. As the car continues to rotate before us, we can start to take a look at some of the smaller details on the model as we zoom in. This model is a little bit of a departure in terms of the run-of-the-mill Minichamps models that we've been getting. Typically, what you see from Minichamps are features such as movable steering, sometimes you get working suspension, sometimes you even get removable components, not necessarily on the late model Formula One cars, but on some other cars you get removable bodywork, opening features, things like that. Not the case with this one. This model overall strikes me more so as something coming from a company like Spark rather than Minichamps. It is a departure from what we have seen from Minichamps lately, and I'm not sure if it's necessarily good or bad. It's just a little bit different. One of the features that immediately becomes apparent on this model is, like most Spark models and like most BBR Formula One models anyway, you do not have functional steering on this car. The steering is completely fixed, and the steering wheel in the cockpit doesn't move, and we'll be able to take a look in the cockpit later on, but the steering is fixed on this one, and it's a little bit of a departure from Minichamps. Typically, Minichamps, they're one of the only companies that really have maintained working steering on these late model Formula One cars, so to see it go away, it's a little bit of a loss, in my opinion. But some of the other things that you do get on the car perhaps go some way into compensating us for that lack of a feature. Taking a look at the front end here as the car swings around, you can see immediately that we have some incredibly intricate detail going on in that front wing and nose area. Just take a look at all of that. The Alfa Romeo was very distinctive in 2019 for certain details on the car. The front wing was one of those very distinct details. When this car was unveiled on Valentine's Day of 2019, that's February 14th, for those of you who live under rocks, you could see that immediately there was furor over that front wing, and we'll take a closer look at it later on, but you can just see the outboard profiles of the main plane and the flaps on that front wing. They just sort of twist outboard, and they create a lot of aerodynamic outwash, and that's something that the 2019 revisions to the aerodynamic regulations and the overall plan of the front wings, it's something that the rules makers were trying
trying to mitigate because it creates turbulence for cars following. However, Alfa Romeo and Ferrari and later on every other team, they found a workaround, and it had something to do with the geometries of those flaps on the front wing. So that was the first detail that really struck everybody. The second detail, as the nose comes back around, was the nose tip itself. Take a look. You have the nose tip low, as is homologated, but you have these big ducts going through the nose tip, as well as two little nostril sections running on either side of the nose tip. And this is something that we have seen before, and many teams incorporate something like that into their front-end design, but it was the first time that we'd ever seen something as dramatic looking as that. And of course, it came first on the Alfa Romeo of 2019. So, two very distinctive things. The third very distinctive thing is the intake snorkel on top of the car. And of course, this section of the car is where the engine is drawing most, if not all, of its intake air. And on most Formula One cars of late, we have seen this section be basically uniform on most of the cars. We have seen it be a central and single channel running through the roll structure of the car underneath that T-shaped bar on top there that serves as a camera mount. But as you can see here, quite obviously, Alfa Romeo not following that overall formula. Rather than doing that and going that route, what they decided to do was have the roll bar in place as a fixed piece of bodywork, as is homologated in the rules, but really do nothing more with it. What they have done is put additional bodywork to either side of that roll bar, as well as above and behind it, and that forms the constituent parts of the air intake on the engine. Very unique design. We have seen a few Formula One teams do things similar to this, but the most recent example that I can recall was Mercedes going back to 2010, and I believe, don't quote me on this, but I believe one of the Caterham or Lotus cars may have done something like this in 2012 or 2013, but no, I could not recall any other instance of an air intake looking like that on any other Formula One car, except, very much except, for the Sauber of 2017. And of course, that car is a direct predecessor of this car. The Sauber C37 of 2018 also featured a similar air intake, and 2019 also for the Alfa Romeo at this point featuring a very similar air intake. So it's a unique design. It's something that a handful of teams have used in the past, but only one still does now, and that is Alfa Romeo. I do remember the first occurrence of that as we see it being on the Ferrari 640 of 1989. Before that, James Hunt's McLarens, they had twin air intakes as well, but very different design philosophy back then. So really, in the modern era, we saw it in 1989 for a couple of races, and then we didn't see it ever again until Mercedes did it in 2010 on the B-spec of the W01. But yeah, it's a unique detail, and it's something that you'll see only on the Alfa Romeo. Moving down now on the front section of the C38, what have we got here? This is our front wing, and you can see that very unique design that we were speaking about just before. First of all, you have got your front wing main plane down low and in the center, so that is the main plane of the wing, the principal structure of the wing. And then on your outboard sides, you have got the flap elements, and these are the parts of the wing that start to generate the majority of your downforce. So you can see the very unique shape of the trailing edge of these flaps on either side of the wing. And this was to try and get around the regulations that mandated these wings become a little bit wider and a little bit lower for 2019, because they wanted to cut out on outwash. And outwash is the aerodynamic phenomenon wherein the designers try to steer air around the front wheels, because these generate a lot of drag and a lot of turbulence, and they will slow the car down and just in general make the car a whole lot less efficient aerodynamically. And they therefore steer air around the front wheels, but when the air is steered around the front wheels, it becomes very turbulent, and then it really does spoil the wake for the cars then following behind this one, which causes their front wings to lose downforce. They lose efficiency, meaning that the cars cannot follow each other as closely as possible through high-speed corners, which means that they cannot set up overtakes, which means the races become processional. That's always been the case in Formula One, because when cars need to turn right and left at different speeds and at different times, you're going to create some dirty air, as they call it. But it's something that Formula One has been trying to fight basically since the inception of aerodynamics and racing. And they're always going to fail at it, in my opinion. But that was how the rules makers decided to tackle it for 2019. It didn't work, but they'll continue to try. And in 2022, we're going to get a complete redesign of the Formula One technical regulations to try and bring the cars perhaps a tenth of a second more closely together through the high-speed corners, even though there still won't be any overtaking. But all of that aside, that's why Alfa Romeo and Ferrari later on had a front wing that had this very shallow open curve on the trailing edge of the upper flaps there, trying to create some of that outwash that was lost by the deletion of all these cascade elements and things that used to be in these flap sections of the wings. Now it's just completely open, as you can see. Returning to the nose section of the car, there is our nose tip. And as we continue to move downward, you can see the nose tip there. Obviously, in reality, all of these sections would be hollowed out and open, but as you can see here on the model, they have blanked them off behind the fascia here. But you can see nose tip with a duct in it, and then the two nostrils on either side, perhaps looking ever so slightly asymmetrical, but two nostrils on either side. And the idea of this would be we want to feed the nose here, because we have ducting that goes through the nose, exiting up top here to create a little bit more positive pressure in this section, create some downforce, as well as to start funneling air around the nose underneath the car to start feeding, believe it or not, the rear zone of the car. Immediately as the car runs into the airstream, it's immediately already trying to think about how are we going to manage the airflow out the back where all of this air exits. So all of that design work goes into the front wing because of how important it is for conditioning the flow for all of the other bits of bodywork that the air is going to run into before the car is finally done with it. Taking a look now at the right side of the car, and now we start to see things looking a bit more conventional, but of course, conventionality only goes so far when we're talking about a Formula One design. The end fences here, the right end fence of the front wing visible currently, you can see just how plain it is. In years prior to this, we would have seen the end fences have very sophisticated geometries. They would have had all sorts of cuts and swoops and dive planes and things like that. Not at all seen on this end fence. All we see is basically a straight across panel. There's a little bit of a curve outboard toward the rear section, about the rear third of it, but the rest of it, just straight and level, complete 90 degree right angle here. We do have still the inverted U-channel vortex generator along the bottom side of the end fence, but none of the cascades, none of the flow modifiers, none of the little turning vanes, nothing at all like that. Just straight and level, completely unremarkable. Coming across here, here is the right front wheel and tire assembly. You can see mini champs in there doing their typically good detailing on the wheel and tire. If we'll focus, there we go. So we can see that we have got a rather sophisticated geometry of that wheel. You can see the outer ring there in the center part of the wheel. That's just, I would assume, for some aerodynamic effects, probably to get some air extracted from the wheel hub. Then, of course, we've got our spokes and then our central wheel nut there. Just a single wheel nut on a Formula One axle makes for very quick pit stops. Sometimes these guys can change four wheels in under 2 seconds, if you can believe it. So very, very fast action in the pits in Formula One. Moving rearward, there is the upper wishbone of that front suspension. That is the rear upper wishbone there. The push rod is just barely visible. And then, of course, moving downward and aft, you can see that we have got the beginning of more aerodynamic fun. All of these devices that you can see in roughly low center of frame right now, what is this? These are barge boards, and for 2019, barge boards went absolutely crazy, particularly when it was announced that these guys would be losing some of that outwash effect from the front wing. They needed to try and regain some of that. Of course, we saw that with the front wing vanes there on the main plane of the wing, the upper flap elements there. However, you also then needed to do something with some of that air that you couldn't try to steer outboard around the front wheels. So if you've got more inflow going toward the center of the car, you need to do things with it. Enter barge boards, all of these barge boards, all of these vertical elements that you can see here, these very jagged stepped elements in the barge boards, they're all separate elements. And they're all angled differently, they have different shapes, they have different sizes, and what they're trying to do is micromanage every last molecule, basically, of diatomic oxygen that is going through that section. It's absolutely phenomenal what they're able to do with the aerodynamic treatment on Formula One cars today. And of course, the Sauber organization, Sauber becoming Alfa Romeo, these guys had one of the best wind tunnels in the world, and they also had one of the best supercomputers in the world in terms of computing all of this aerodynamic data. So the need for actual real-world testing being obviated by supercomputing, as well as that really great wind tunnel, but they're very limited nowadays in terms of what they're allowed to do with things like wind tunnels and even supercomputers and computational fluid dynamics, because the FIA always makes rules that they don't need. But regardless, we do have crazy aerodynamic details on this car. I can't even begin to count how many separate elements there are. Just in this section alone, all the black elements here that you can see, these are all separate barge board elements. And the Sauber, the Alfa Romeo, whatever we want to call it, absolutely not at all unique in this regard. Every Formula One car of 2019 had absolutely insane levels of aerodynamic detail work going on just in this section alone with the barge board. Barge boards used to be relatively simplistic structures. They were just basically flat panels mounted vertically along the flanks of the monocoque here on either side. But nowadays, nope, they are completely different. They are very much integral structures, not only to the front end of the car just structurally, but they're also integral to the car's overall aerodynamic performance. If you were to lose a barge board or damage a barge board, the whole car doesn't work anymore. So that is why we have such a level of sophistication with the detail in the design of these components. Moving rearward, we can now see some larger individual elements. More barge board, more turning vane, this very large vertical vane here. This is a turning vane, you can see, which then interfaces with this turning vane in white that you can see, which then interfaces with this turning vane also in white, which interfaces with a little winglet above it that we can't quite see due to the angle, and then that interfaces with the floor of the car, which then continues to run outboard and rearward all the way toward the diffuser at the rear end. Also here, toward the low side, toward the reference plane, we have got ourselves this little fence, this separate element above the actual edge of the reference plane. This is a fence just to keep some air from spilling out over the side of the car there and creating more drag, therefore turbulence, and therefore less top speed. So anything that these guys can do to get the most minute advantage, they're going to do it, and they don't care how much it costs. Moving rearward, we have got the Coke bottle section of the car. Moving inboard now toward the top side of the diffuser, we've got more turning vanes here mounted horizontally on the reference plane, and then we can't see it due to the angle, but this section here on the floor is all cut out with gills that are enclosed, moving rearward there. Again, just trying to control a little bit of the high pressure zones around the tires there, because again, these big tires out in the airstream, they generate a lot of drag, so anything to cut down on that drag is going to be useful. Rear axle, so rear tire and rear wheel assembly there. You can see, once again, great detail from Mini Champs. They differ somewhat from the front wheels in that we have got these deep dish 13-inch wheels here on the rear. They're also 13 inches on the front, but they are much more conventional looking in terms of they are not these deep set, almost split rim designs on the rear, but same spokes, same central wheel nut, and then of course they are all wrapped in the Pirelli P0 tires here because we are assuming dry conditions and nice and bright and sunny skies. Rear wing, as we continue to move up here, we have got ourselves these massive rear wing end fences that we've been seeing on these cars since 2017 and the aerodynamics overhaul in Formula One, but you can see just how complex all of this is. Basically, the entire structure of the rear wing end fence from this point to this point, it's non-structural. It's just for aerodynamics. The only bit of support going on for the rear wing here, at least from outboard, is this very narrow strip that is mostly hidden by the rear tire here. But yes, this is all, from this point to this point, strictly aerodynamic, no structural support whatsoever to the rear wing proper, meaning that all of the forces going through that wing are carried through this little section as well as through the support pylons that are mounted centrally on the wing. But really, in all, we don't have all of that much holding these wings together, yet they can withstand thousands of kilograms of relative aerodynamic pressure as the car is running at speed. Amazing structures these are. Taking a look at the rear zone on C38 now, things start to look a little bit more familiar. Here, of course, is our rear wing main plane and the upper flap. This is where DRS would be, so this section of the flap would pop open. when the car is in the DRS zone and within 1 second of the car in front, because that's what the rules say. Although, you know, back in 2011 it was a free-for-all and it was awesome, but yes. No actuating DRS on this model, but this is where the flap is, and it would just pop open forward relative to our position, opening up the slot gap right down through here, thus reducing drag down the straights. Below that, you can see the two support struts that are carrying not only all of the weight and aerodynamic download going through the rear wing, but they're also carrying hydraulic lines to actuate that DRS, so splitting that into two halves there. Moving centrally and a little bit more inboard, a little bit farther from our eye point, you can see the exhaust from the Ferrari engine. The lower pipe is all engine exhaust, so that's coming straight out of the engine. The two pipes on top here are turbocharger wastegate exhaust. Only one turbocharger on a Formula One engine, but we have got two outpipes for the turbo wastegates there. Below that, you can see that we have got ourselves the rear crash structure and rain light, as you can see here. So the rear crash structure runs basically from the end of the gearbox casing back here all the way rearward. And there's a little winglet on top of it as well. And then above and slightly ahead, you can see that we have got ourselves this T-wing on either side of the rear wing proper right there. So little T-wing there. They have been taken down massively from what they had been in 2017, used in conjunction with the shark fin engine covers, but still exist to some extent, and there it was on the 2019 Alfa Romeo. Moving downward yet again, what else have we got? We have got, of course, our rear suspension. So here we have our wishbone on either side, and then below that, might just be able to get the light in there so we can see it. Yeah, we have got a pull rod below that, so pull rod there. And then, obviously, you will have a lower wishbone through this section as well, but not quite visible due to our angle. Also on this shot, you can quite readily see the diffuser. Diffuser is very important on Formula One cars, and they're very important basically on any sort of race car that's running fast enough to make use of a diffuser, but very complicated geometries. These were knocked down significantly from what they were in some of the glory years, the early 2000s, for example. Cars like the Ferrari F2004, McLaren MP420, for example, have absolutely massive diffusers. But this one, nothing to sneeze at. However, not nearly as sophisticated in terms of how big they were. Lots of aerodynamic appendages, these little vanes coming down from the reference plane toward the ground, and also what they've been doing with diffusers lately is they're layering all of these different carbon panels together, creating these slot gaps for air to fire through at very high rates of speed, thus creating very low zones of pressure just behind there. So more downforce being created that way. But really, if the teams had full leeway to do what they wanted, you would have all of these vanes going straight down to the floor, and they'd be sealing the diffuser, basically creating a big tunnel down here to create a lot of downforce that way with the under tray. We are going to see that again in Formula One, slated to happen now in 2022, but for the moment, we are attempting to create some of that effect within the letter of the law, and the letter of the law at this point is you can only have your diffuser be that low, which of course means that you're going to be in a compromised position always. But yes, the rear side of the car, very complicated, very important on a Formula One car these days. It'll continue to be important for the balance of 2020 and 2021, as basically designs from 2019 and 2020 will be carried over with minimal changes for 2021. But 2022, all of this goes by the wayside. In addition to all of this, just want to draw your attention to this section of the car here, how open this is. Of course, this is mostly for cooling because very high temperature components running through here. You've got your engine, you've got your turbocharger, you've got your gearbox, all sorts of radiators and things through this section. All of that exhaust air, all of that heated air going through the radiator matrices exhausts here out the back. In years gone by, we used to see big chimneys running on the sides of Formula One cars, but all of those have been banned as well, meaning that the teams are running all of their radiator exhaust, just the hot air that's gone through the radiators, they're just firing it out the back of the monocoque and out the back of the engine cover right through here. So that is why we have such a big hole at the back of a Formula One car. And you can even see some of the struts and some of the sleeves that the screws are mounted inside here for holding this model together. So pretty cool. And of course, a look at the left side of the car, looking very similar to the right side of the car, quite obviously, just a mirror image thereof. But I did want to draw your attention to the engine cover area on the car, not only because of, well, it's the same thing we just saw, but we have got ourselves basically the only vestige of that 2017 design on the engine cover. This minuscule little vestigial shark fin carrying Kimi Raikkonen's number 7 right now. But this is all that remains of the shark fins that used to extend from the top of the roll bar, basically, from that height anyway, all the way to join up with the rear wing in this section here, basically to join up with where the top of the DRS actuator pod is. So all of that was knocked down for 2018 because enough people on Twitter said it was ugly, even though it wasn't ugly at all, and it made the cars faster, and you're wrong, Twitter, but yeah, Twitter spoke, and therefore shark fins were banned. However, these little sections right here can remain, quite conveniently, because it gives the team a place to put Kimi Raikkonen's number, and of course, Antonio Giovinazzi's number 99 was also on his car in that same section as well. Speaking of Kimi Raikkonen, though, there is Kimi Raikkonen sitting in the office, if you can just barely see him sitting there. Let's take the camera up freehand and take a little bit of a closer look at some of these details. Going freehand with the camera now, and we can start to take some closer looks at some of the finer details on the car. First of all, obviously the front wing, and you can see just how intricate it still is, even though it is greatly simplified from what they had been in 2017 and 2018. You can still see that we have got the flap adjusters there that many champs have bothered to detail, as you can see coming back into focus. There we go. Very nice detail. You do see that all of the separate wing elements there are rendered as one piece here, just for the sake of simplicity on the model, but these would in reality be all separate elements. You can see many champs just cheating a little bit there, trying to put some black paint in there to make them superficially appear like separate elements, but no, the wing is all one piece. These would all really be like the serrated edges of a shaving razor, really, the multi-blade razors that you can get. That's how these wings really are in reality, and that's just trying to create those slot gaps for the air to shoot through at tremendous velocity and lower the overall pressure, creating downforce there. There's the nose tip. As we discussed earlier here, you can see that it is just blanked off there moving rearward, but it is there. The geometries of the openings at least look good. And then moving up the nose proper, there is the Alfa Romeo in the traditional colors, the Alfa Romeo logo there with an old flag of Milano. It's Milan, Italy, for all of our terrible anglicized versions of Italian names. And then we've got the serpent and the Saracen in the mouth. Yes, Carrera, the slot car sets, and the watchmakers and all kinds of things. I don't think there's actually a relation between those two. Whatever. Singhai, I think, is a Singaporean thing. Pirelli, whatever this company is. Whatever this company is. No, I'm getting Pirelli. They make electronics for cars, among other things. Kimi Raikkonen is number 7, a pitot tube. And then some antennas for radio and telemetry and all kinds of things. There is the neutral button there, the emergency clutch for the marshals or the driver even in some cases to pop a stranded car out of gear and so that it could roll. The central stay of Halo, and then there is Kimi Raikkonen in the office. Yes, there we go. A little bit tricky sometimes to get the light in there because of how Halo is, but you can see Kimi Raikkonen's helmet nicely detailed as you can see there. Trying to get the focus back, and it's there. Yes, Kimi Raikkonen's helmet looks good. Just moving the light around so we can get the shadows to fall differently. We can highlight different areas on the helmet, but very nice indeed. And speaking of Halo, there is the central stay of Halo. You can see the Shell logo on the top section of Halo there toward the center, much like Ferrari also have run. Of course, related teams, you can call them sister teams. Rear section of the cockpit surround, the lateral sections of the cockpit surround. You can see all that bolstering just to keep the driver's head in place should there be a big accident. And then the T-bar on top with the camera mount, as well as the intake snorkel for the engine. Very distinctive intake snorkel, as we have discussed prior, and it looks very nice. I do like the overall design of that. It's very unique, and it's actually one of the reasons I want to get this model, because there's really no other car that looks like it, and, well, mini champs, you don't really go wrong with these guys. Let's take a look at all the geometries around the engine cover there. You can just see how narrow the car actually is in that central section, and again, the more narrow you can keep it, the more aerodynamically efficient it's going to become, and you can just see through here, as we pull up,
how narrow it is, and now everything tapers down toward the rear. Because again, the more narrow you can get, the less cross-sectional area you have aerodynamically, which means the less drag you produce, the more efficiently you can use your engine power for top speed, and the more empty space you have to play with right there in the top section of the diffuser to try and create more downforce at the rear end where you really, 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 really need it. Barge boards now, you can see in some more detail just how intricate they are. I mean, all of these separate elements running through the barge boards, you can see where they're connected to the monocoque, and then they start to branch off immediately, and they break up into all of these separate elements with different little dive planes and turning vanes and all kinds of things that are constituent parts unto themselves. But when you pull out and see the forest through the trees, you can see how they all work together. It's absolutely mind-blowing the amount of detail and thought and execution that has to go into designing parts like these. Even on a model car, never mind the real thing, it's absolutely wild. And you can even see more simplistic barge boards there underneath the nose. Absolute bedlam going on there with all of the design. Turning vanes that we saw earlier, there we go. And then, of course, the radiator inlets on the car. We don't have any attempt at a radiator matrix behind those openings. They're just painted black to look like empty caverns, but there is no opening there at all. It's just a black panel that's been painted there in the mold. Once again, top side, there is the cockpit surround. There is Halo from the side. You can get a better look now at the little vane that's on top of Halo. They're allowed to do that to condition the airflow a little bit better in this section of the car. It works pretty nicely. Wing mirrors, the right-hand wing mirror anyway, is visible there with its little nacelle, its little fairing almost. Looks nice. If we focus, there we go. Not bad, and you can see the mirror stalk as well. If we come around and view that from forward, you can see more so how the stalk is and how it's integrated into the turning vane up top here, connected to the bottom side of the mirror fairing, and then it moves outboard where it is not quite connected to the outboardmost turning vane here, but it does interface with it very closely. So you can see overall how they're trying to link these parts together. Side of the engine cover yet again, there's a side view of the snorkel. There is the quadrifoglio, the four-leaf clover. That is something that Alfa Romeo has always put on their premier-level models, and a Formula One car is a premier-level model, as far as I'm concerned. Decal for the emergency kill switch, in case the car needs to be shut down, and then we get into the branding. Stelvio here, that is Alfa Romeo's soccer mom crossover thing, and Giulia, the Giulia sedan that Alfa Romeo also makes would have been on car number 99, Antonio Giovinazzi's car. But Raikkonen's car has had Stelvio on it for his tenure at Alfa Romeo. Raikkonen is number 7 on the little shark fin, and then we get this kind of abstract-looking negative space white Alfa Romeo emblem design here. Very cool. Branding Alfa Romeo on the side. And then the cockpits around. Very cool. Contingency auxiliary sponsors along the reference plane where the side pod matches up with the reference plane. And then here, this only reference, this sole reference on the car, Sauber Engineering, that is the only reference, the only adage, laud, whatever, to Sauber that is paid anywhere on this livery, anywhere on this car, even though this car very much is designed by the same people who ran Sauber. So there's the heritage for you right there. Rear wing, main plane, flap. There's the DRS actuator pod, the two swan neck supports. That's your primary support for the rear wing. But just through here, you can see the end fences on this rear wing. You can see the gills that are cut through there for more aerodynamic benefit. And then just that red section moving forward. That is the only section on this wing that actually is structurally integral to the integrity of that wing. That is pretty wild. And of course, you can see all the branding on that. Lower side, little striations, little gills coming down from the end fence. That's very McLaren-esque. I remember McLaren doing that in 2017. It looked very nice. Didn't work for McLaren, but it looked good. And then the rear side of the rear crash structure. And then, of course, the diffuser, a little winglet coming off of the rear crash structure there as well. Looking very good. Very, very good indeed. Tread area on the tires. Of course, really, there is just one big tread block on the tire because it's slick. Tires, though, they are scuffed, as you can see. Make it look like they've been driven on a little bit. Little floor stays.
moving back toward the center line of the car, just keeping the floor intact. And here you can see how the light is shining through these holes on the floor. They are actual open sections enclosed within the boundary of the reference plane there along the floor. Just get a little bit more airflow through there to cut down on aerodynamic stalling. There is one of the pull rods of the rear suspension. Moving forward through there. Looking nice. Very, very nice indeed. And now just taking a look topside here on the C38, specifically the cockpit. There is the cockpit, and we mentioned that the steering on this model is inoperable. There is no steering. However, we do have, as compensation, if you like, a pretty decently detailed cockpit, including a pretty decently detailed steering wheel. Just take a look at that. It does have all the decals on it, trying to emulate as best as it can the buttons and switches on the Alfa Romeo steering wheel of 2019, and it doesn't look all that bad. It's not the most detailed steering wheel that I've got in the collection, but it's certainly far from the worst. You can see that silver area in the center where they're trying to emulate the placement of the LCD, the main display for the car, on the steering wheel there. Looks pretty nice, I do have to say, but no steering works on this car, unfortunately. Taking a look into the cockpit, there is our driver figure in there. No photo-etched parts in here in terms of seat belts or buckles, but we do have the seat belts represented there with stickers, as you might have been able to tell. And of course, we do have Kimi Raikkonen's helmet through this section here. Take a look at that. It's on top of his helmet design, which really hasn't changed all that much in the last, I don't know, 13 or so years? Long time Kimi Raikkonen has been in Formula 1 since 2001. Anyway, top side of the monocoque here from another angle. Really the only other detail that we can see now that we could not before is the exit of the S duct. This is the duct that is fed from those nostrils along either side of the nose tip on the front end of the car. There is the exit of the S duct, and of course the air exiting up here, creating some downforce top side for basically no drag penalty whatsoever. So if you can get an S-duct into your nose cone on an F1 car, you're gonna do it because it's basically free real estate. Anyway, there is the front suspension, double wishbone pushrod, as we said, and the little winglets on either side of the nose visible there in black against a black backdrop. So a little bit difficult to see, but they are there. FIA camera mount here on, actually it's on both sides of the nose, but the left side one visible there. Front wing pylons holding that front wing to the nose cone, the FIA Action Road Safety branding there, and then of course your left front wheel and tire. Very nicely done there with all of that. Rear sides of those turning vanes now, and then of course once again the cockpit. Decently detailed, I've got to say. As I said at the beginning, it's kind of like a Spark model. It's a little bit different from your typical run-of-the-mill mini champs. It's not bad by any means. It's just a little bit different. I am left wanting for steering. It's a very weird detail, and most people don't even care about it, I'm led to believe, but I kind of want steering. I'm missing it. It adds something.
So there it was, the Alfa Romeo C38, rendered in 1/18th scale by Minichamps. It is a little bit of a departure from the Minichamps products that we're used to seeing, particularly these late model Formula One cars, and really the feature that I miss the most in this is operable steering. Now, the aerodynamic details and the macrocosmic details on the car, they are a step up, in my opinion, in terms of what Minichamps generally give us. Yes, there have been some models, even in my collection, that have approached this, if even maybe we're on par with this from Minichamps. In particular, I'm thinking about the 2017 Mercedes that we took a look at about a year and a half ago now. That one is very good, and that one also features operable steering. So I don't quite understand why Minichamps are making the decisions that they are. Overall, in terms of detail, in terms of construction, in terms of quality, they haven't changed at all. They are still definitely the best in the business for this price point in a 1/18th scale model. But I do miss the steering. I can't deny it, and I can't quite understand why, but I miss the steering. It's a feature that I like in a 1/18th scale car. They're big enough to have that detail operable. Make the steering work, please. Other than that, though, I really can't criticize too much else. The only other thing that I will draw your attention to is on the front end, the right front wheel. The camber is all out of line on it, and I don't know why. It has a lot of inboard camber relative to the center line of the car, and I can't quite figure out why that is. The wheel is solidly mounted, it doesn't move around, it doesn't flex, the suspension is not damaged, it's not crooked in any way, it just appears that the wheel hub was mounted crooked there, and I may have to take the wheel off or figure out how to take the wheel off in order to rectify that. But until I do figure out the best course of action for that, it's there, it's on the car, it doesn't look good. I will try to figure out a way of fixing that, and perhaps I'll even show you the repair process on that. But aside from there, we have got ourselves a very decent package here from Mini Champs in 1/18th scale. It's the first Alfa Romeo model of any kind in my collection, and therefore it's the first Formula One Alfa Romeo as well. Kimi Raikkonen, of course, you can't go wrong with him. He is one of my favorite racing drivers of all time, and he is still in Formula One. 20 years in Formula One, basically. That's pretty remarkable. That's an exceptionally long career doing anything, never mind being an elite level racing driver, and of course being a world champion along the way as well. But there it was, the Alfa Romeo C38 of 2019 in 1/18th scale by Mini Champs. I do hope that you all enjoyed this one, and perhaps you learned a little something along the way. Thank you all very much for watching. Ferrari Man 601 saying thanks, and of course we will see you soon.